Hey, good morning, folks. So, kind of a bit of introduction, right? So, I'm Milan Joshi. I'm working with Barclaycard, right? I am based in India, right? And in US, we have our office in Delaware, right? Bit of introduction on the Barclaycard US side first, right? So, in 2000, like we had a Juniper Bank that was formed, right? And after 4 years in 2004. So Juniper Bank was sold out by the investors to the Barclays Bank PLC group, right? And then this Barclaycard US journey started off, right? So primarily Barclaycard US, it provides your partnership and co-branded credit cards, right? So when I talk about partnership and co-branded credit cards, right? So it is like partners like Apple, LL Bean, US Airways. Okay, these are which we with the Barclays partners out, right? Then it's as per the issuing sequencing, it's the ninth largest issuer in the United States right now, but it's growing pretty fast, right? Already on the top side in the UK market, but in US it's growing pretty fast here, right? As part of the integrations that we manage out, right? So like I said, with the partners like the Apple and the Priceline one, and then associations really important in the credit card business. We have Visa and Amex. Right, and then for the system of records, we have banking platforms which we integrate, like TCS and FDR, the first data record. Right, so this is a bit of introduction on the Barclaycard US side. So how I'll take it through from here is like what is our architecture? Okay, then where does this ESB comes into picture? And then when ESB comes into picture, then why we are using WSO2ESB and its various products. Right. Okay, so this is about our channel and partner integrations. So how it is structured out, right, is so we have a service-oriented architecture in our what we call as API domain, right? So we have got different channels integrating with us. Channel means like a customer website, right? It can be a contact center agent. Then a very important functionality, the IVR. So I think we were talking about yesterday in the presentation from West, right? How it is important for the customers, for the customer experience that we need, right? So then there's something known as account aggregators. I'm not sure if you've heard about it. So that's Mint and Yodlee, right? So they continuously screen scrape our website. So I'll be giving a use case on this, showing a use case where we have effectively used WSO2ESB over there, right? It was one of the critical projects that we did, right? And then we also interact with our vendors like CrowdTwist, for loyalty edge reward points, right, using ESB, right? So it's just like customer website consuming SOAP services and leveraging ESB for bulk loading of account data. So it's pretty simple, right? So when you have your online website, okay, where you are registered with a credit card, right, you log in with your credentials there. Then you have an account summary on login page coming out. There's lots of data on it, right? So, and that is how the performance of the website counts for a credit card, you know, kind of a bank, right? So there we have leveraged ESB solution for some of the partners using single sign-on, right? The second one I talked about, the IVR one, right? So one of the important functionality we did there was for certain speech-enabled IVR systems, kind of finding out the SSN or the primary account number data, right? So there we leveraged this middleware platform ESP on that, right? Then apply side is fine, where we are acquiring the web app applications. Contact center we don't use much for ESP kind of thing, right? Then account aggregator, as I told, where we use the open financial exchange interface, right? And using WSO2 products. Okay, so this is how it is structured out, right? Your SOA, that is your service-oriented architecture and its stages, right? So eventually if you, we've been hearing since last 2-3 days here in the conference, right? So we're having different variety of products from WSO2, which eventually kind of they map out with the various SOA stages as well, right? Where you have the creation and the exposure of the proxies, how you identify your services, right? How you test your services, then managing services or monitoring of the services, right? And then integration of the services, that is using your ESP. If you see at the diagram, right, all these are structured out and they all commonly, they kind of aggregate to SOA governance. They can help you achieve the SOA governance over there. Then On top of it, you have the IT governance, and then you have finally the corporate or the enterprise governance. Right? So it's like SOA governance, it extends the IT governance, and that extends your enterprise or the corporate governance. Right? So this is a very broad or high-level view of how it is structured out in your stages of the service-oriented architecture. Right. So now it comes, why ESP? Right. It allows you loose coupling of the components. Right. Then it also centralizes your global functions like logging and security mechanisms. Speaking about security, right? So we had this password callback handler implementation we use from ESP, right? Where we use the Apache Rampart using, and that is on the access to module. Right, that's really important and really required in a financial institution like Barclays, right? So where we have our secure proxies. Okay, so we have a customized kind of jars, right? We call it a password callback handler, which is embedded, okay, and it resides on your components, lib on your ESP server, right? So that is used over there, and it helps us achieve the username token security. Right, so we were initially using X509, then we migrated to username token using this password callback handler. Okay, then logging is another important aspect. Right, so we have written kind of with the help of WSO2 support, we wrote the custom log mediator. Right, so again talking about the financial institution. Right, we have certain sensitive data that we need to kind of mask in the logs that come in the production service. Right. So we cannot show SSN or the permanent account number, right? So there we kind of leverage the custom mediators, right, for logging. Then it really allows the data to be aggregated at a point and also route to multiple destinations, right? So I have a slide further where I'll show you how it is routing to multiple destinations and using some of the important enterprise integration patterns, right, of ESP. Okay, so after why ESP now? Why we have WSO2 ESP, right? So it is. We've heard about like it's completely open source. That's really important, and it's comparatively inexpensive, right? Then the Synapse config that you have, we've been having like a really great time in like kind of changing the code of the Synapse config itself, right? So we can. It provides you a complete insight of the source code, right? So you can actually make modifications to it and then kind of bump it up back on the ESP server, right? Then it provides excellent service orchestration. And again, the use case, I'll explain how it is providing the service orchestration over there, right? Then a variety of useful mediators like throttle, XSLT, clone, iterate, and aggregate, right? So the project that we did, right, a very critical project that we did on this, it utilized all these mediators over there, right? And we do lots of XSLT transformations over this, which kind of reduce our lot of boilerplate coding that we have on Java, right? Then decent service level monitoring setup, right, that we can achieve using your BAM, which is getting revamped into the DAS, right? API management, as we've heard about, right? And then excellent WSO2 support. So support has been really good, and primarily like we in India have been fortunate to get in touch with the folks because our time zone is the same. So we usually have frequent meetings and calls with the WSO2 folks over there. So a bit on the WSO2 and the governance part, right? So we know that governance is kind of an issue for in the SOA, so that is your service-oriented architecture, and it is actually classified as design time, runtime, and change time, right? So we've been hearing in the last two presentations also, right? So this governance registry helps us achieve that, right? So speaking about runtime governance, right? How you do your monitoring of the services, that is your runtime governance. Right, design time, very basic example. So you have your developer studio, which is configured for your designing of the proxies that helps you achieve the design time governance. Right, so basically governance registry comprises of these components, your service registry, service manager, and the policy server. So your WSI policies, they can be on the policy server. Right, then your service manager has the service lifecycle management and the version management. You can do that over there. So basically, how we utilize it is all your contracts, right? All your schema definitions or WSDL or XSLTs. If they are not as local entries, then you can put them on your governance, right? So this is kind of a architecture view in Barclaycard US space, how we have put the ESP platform as a middleware platform, right? So on the second slide, right, I showed you these are the channels that we're talking about, right? The IVR, CCD. So IVR, CCD is the contact center desktop and the website. And then there's a business process management application, right? It comes to a load balancer. Now these service or the domains that we have, right? So we have individual domains, account domain, customer domain, a transaction or a statement domain, right? These are the domains, and then we have the proxies on the ESP. Either we can have simple pass-through proxies, okay? Or else, if there is some kind of transformation or translation that needs to be done, rather than doing it on your Java, we utilize the ESP for that. As I said, primarily the XSLT transformations, right? And sometimes for some partner or vendor integrations as well. So here you can see the some TCS. So TCS is the system of record for that. Some third party, whether it's Verid or Experian proxy, all these are proxy levels that we've configured out, right? So we mainly use the Synapse for this, right? Then we also tried out for some load balance endpoints, right? We are trying to figure that out, how they can kind of work out for us, right? Then apart from this, I've not shown the BAM over here, but I'll give you a simple use case, right? So when a customer logs into the website, right, the call goes to a backend service, right? So apart from the, if it is a SOAP based, right, apart from the SOAP body, you have a SOAP header on top of it, and you have a customized header, right, from which particular channel the call is coming, the user ID and all those things. Not the password, but the user ID, it's captured over there, right? So those kind of metrics we push into the BAM server, right? So the mediation data agents, they are configured on ESB, and with the Thrift, it is kind of linked with the BAM server, right? So we are having some kind of issues with that right now, but probably soon we'll be figuring them out, right? Fix them, right? So the BAM is not in production yet, but you're working over it in lower environments right now. But it is really cool when you see the metrics on board, right? Your service health, so it is very good for service level monitoring that we see. So these are the components that we've leveraged. ESBs, like kind of proxies to services, transformations, then APIs, REST and SOAP, governance server, primarily for service registry, okay, a little bit for managing the APIs, and as I said, monitoring for service usage and call tracking, right? So service usage is really important, right? So you got to know about what all channels your service is getting calls, and how it is the load, and at what time you have a peak load and what time you have a kind of a lesser load on the servers. Okay, so a bit on the deployment strategy, right? So we use Maven for building ESB and the registry artifacts. Then we use a car-based deployment, right? How it works is we have a master POM and then the child POMs of the various projects that we have, the ESB and the registry artifacts, right? They get bundled in a car file, two different car files, one for the ESB and one for the registry. Then we have our Jenkins build and deployment scripts, right, for the lower environments as well. And then production, it's completely different. We have a different production implementation for that. So how it does is it picks from the build server, the artifact, right, and then it shoots to the Carbon Apps 0 folder, right? So from there, it can kind of deploy it. So we initially, when we started this deployment, we were using the worker manager setup, but we kind of had certain issues in it. So if you see this slide, right, the worker manager setup that we have. And on the first day, we had this session also where we kind of talked about it, right? So in your master node, you check in the change, and then the slave or the worker node, right, it checks out the artifacts. So we were having some multi-tenant kind of issues and with some SVN client exceptions that were coming out. So we kind of moved away from that. We are right now using single nodes for that, not a worker manager setup individually. So that was primarily in the lower environments. We never got to see in the production environments. I don't know why. We kind of had a lot of time spent on it, but we eventually moved from that to single nodes for DSP servers, right? And that works pretty fine, right? Yeah, so this was the use case that I was talking about, right? So aggregators, they used to screenscape our website with over 500 logins per minute. Okay, the goal set was to provide them a single API that collates, aggregates, and returns data. Okay, so we utilize the OFX, that is the Open Financial Exchange Protocol, for message transformations, right? So again, so there were over kind of 5,000, 6,000 IPs that the calls were coming from, right? And they had dynamic IPs being generated from various data centers, right? So we had to throttle that out. Right? We cannot take the complete load on the servers. Right? And we utilize the throttling, the throttle mediator of VSV, right? That works pretty well, right? Then cloning is for kind of, because there were 10 to 12 requests that were independent, okay, for the backend services. So we kind of cloned those requests, right? Then after cloning, so we have to have some aggregate configured, right? Where kind of how it works is it actually, the aggregate on the sequence from where it is configured, right? It actually waits on that, okay, till all the requests, they have kind of shooted on that particular sequence. And then there you have the final transformation to whatever data or data type you need to return to the customer or the consumer of the API or the proxy, right? And callout is something not similar to aggregate, but find kind of a timed waiting that you have. Okay, it is something, if you have a dependent call, right, then you use a callout mediator over there, right? So this is the diagram that I was talking about, right? So this is your account aggregator, this is the ESB. So we kind of have a REST API on that, right? We didn't use the API manager, but on the, so when we did this project, we were using ESB 4.7, right? So there we kind of had this REST API implementation. So we've been having really lot of conversations and talks with the support folks, right? So we were having, so initially when I joined Barclays, we were using 4.5. Then I was the one who was kind of responsible for getting this up to 4.7, right? So doing this project over there. And then these are internally, these are SOAP calls, right? And then they use the endpoints configured, they use the username token with the password callback handler I was talking about, right, for internal this calls, right? So, and this is the throttle mediator that I was talking about, where you throttle the application, the input calls you have. That's pretty okay. XSLT transformation. So XSLT kind of writing XSLT is a bit complex, right? So we kind of use the Altova XML spy for that, right? It really helps over there, right? But yeah, it's good. But you need to write optimized XSLTs basically, right? So XSLT, you can kind of move off with the complete performance if you kind of write long or bad XSLTs, kind of having multiple loops over there. So it provides, so the map, the XML spy provides a debugging feature also in it. So we use that. Thank you.